Good afternoon, members. It's the appointed time and we've formed a quorum. Welcome to the fifth meeting of the Bills Committee on Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Amendment Bill 2021. We were on written agreement when it comes to the clause by clause scrutiny at the last meeting. Now, I'd like to discuss with members. Prior to the meeting, we have received CSAs from three parties, including Mr. Tommy Zhang, DAB, and FTU. I suggest we do not discuss the CSAs today. Let's wait till the end of our meeting. And of course, if members would like to briefly introduce the CSAs to us, by all means, but we do not start to deliberate on them today. And may I remind members that we very much hope to complete the scrutiny of the bill by the end of this legislative session. So if you have further CSAs to make, please make sure we can have them before the next meeting scheduled for the next Monday. Now we have to beat the deadline, and we have one meeting scheduled today, another one next Monday. We will I will keep track of the progress today. If we need another meeting, then I'd like to put in another meeting next week. Hopefully, we can complete the scrutiny of the bill within next week. Mr. Tommy Zhang, would you like to introduce your CSAs to us? No. Chairman. Our usual way of dealing with CSA is as you said, but then this bill is rather complicated. We are amending many areas of an old ordinance, and there are quite a few CSAs from different members. I don't mind if you continue to with your clause by clause scrutiny, but let's not wait until the last meeting, because it's hard to say when is the last meeting, because we might want to make further amendments to a member CSA. Taking my as an example, now my CSA refers to a family. Now, for instance, I have the landlord. I have three bedrooms in my apartment, and I like to rent one room to a family with one or two families. I don't rule out the possibility of renting two rooms, two different families respectively. So there are three families living together in one apartment. So, of course, I want my CSA covering two families to be passed, if not one family. I don't know whether a member would like to further amend my CSA to make it two rooms instead of one room rented out. And I may have amendments to other member CSAs as well. So I don't know when will be the last meeting. Hopefully that come next week, we can consider the CSAs. Is better than waiting until the last meeting, which it would be hard to say. And last Tuesday, you wanted to schedule a meeting for Tuesday, which is an exco date. Now the next meeting is next Monday. That's fine. But if you schedule another one that clash with my exco meeting, then that would put me in a difficult position. Thank you. All right, Mr. Tommy Zhang is not asking us to consider members' CSAs now. Perhaps it will be sometime next week. And the administration would also need time to consider those amendments. Unless Mr. Tommy Zhang insists, so we are not going to start discussing the CSAs today. Now, the next meeting is next Monday, and we'll see whether we want to start discussing the CSAs next week. And if members would like to briefly introduce the amendments to us, by all means, although we are quite clear about Mr. Tommy Zhang's amendment. So, members, what are your views? I don't mind. I just want to make sure that we have time to consider the CSAs. After all, I haven't given members ample time to see the CSA. If I remember correctly, I circulated my own CSA last Thursday, and the legal advisor may need to consider them as well. So I don't mind continuing with what we've been doing. But then if I heard you correctly, you said that you would consider the CSAs at the last meeting. My concern is we don't know when is the last. So I don't mind business as usual today. And then I hope next week we can have myself and three other members and maybe more to discuss the CSAs. And then after that, we can go back to cross-by-cross scrutiny. And when we have wrapped up everything, we'll see whether there are loose ends to tie. And if everything is fine, then the bill can resume its second reading debate. All right. So we will continue with cross-by-cross scrutiny, and we will wait for the administration's response tentatively. I think we need two or three more meetings, and if members don't want to wait until the very end, let's see if we can consider members' CSAs at the next meeting. All right, if members have no further comments, can we start our cross-by-cross scrutiny? Well, we were at 120AAZ, written tenancy. Yes, Under Secretary. In fact, we hope that after today's meeting, we will meet with different parties to discuss with them the administration's initial response to their CSAs. Yes, you can do as you plan, but still we need to consider those CSAs at our BC meeting. All right, thank you. Please refer to marked up copy page 0023. We completed section 120AAY. Now we have to consider 120AAZ tenancy in writing for first term tenancy. We do understand. Page 23, page 0023 of the marked up copy, page 23. Is section 120AAZ tenancy in writing for the first term tenancy, division 3. We do understand. The written tenancy is most important for protecting the interest of tenants. So for the first tenancy, the tenant can require the landlord to deliver a written tenancy within 30 days. And if the landlord fails to do so, then the tenant may withhold the rent until the tenancy agreement is received. And if the landlord fails to do so, then the tenant can give a notice of no more than 30 days for termination of the tenancy. And then the tenant, upon receipt of the written tenancy, will have to sign it and have it returned to the landlord, and any withheld rent must be paid to the landlord within 15 days. Failure of the tenant to comply with this can allow the landlord to give a written notice of no less than 15 days for termination of the tenancy. Any question, please? Mr. Tong Li Zi. Well, if the landlord doesn't sign the tenancy agreement, should there be any penalty imposed? Administration. Now, the tenant can can require the landlord to provide a copy within 30 days. If the landlord fails to do so, then the tenant has two options. One, withhold the rent, and second, she has the right to terminate the tenancy. So the tenant can continue to withhold rent payment until the tenancy agreement reaches him. So within 30 days, the landlord will have to sign and return the agreement, and the tenant can choose not to pay any rent starting from day one. Well, first, the tenant has to make such a request. He has to make a request for a written tenancy to be delivered to him. And then after 30 days, if the request is not complied with, then he can withhold rent. So usually, you have to give advance payment of rent. So he has to pay the rent in advance and then give a written request to the landlord to sign the agreement and have it returned to him. And if after 30 days that's not done, then there are two options for the tenant. He can continue to live in the premises but not pay the rent. Yes, withhold rent on a temporary basis. And when the tenancy agreement is signed and returned, then he will have to pay the withheld rent. Yes.
I have a contract. A question about the standard contract. Would a template be provided for tenants or members of the public? When will tenants of SDUs be informed of such? We are going to create a template, and the contents of such depends on the content of the bill as passed, and we will proceed to drafting the template at that time. Would it be drafted by the Transport and Housing Bureau or Rating and Valuation Department? The government will make arrangements accordingly. Any other questions? If not, we will move on. We now move on to Subdivision 4, Tenants' Interest in Certain Circumstances. 120AAZA, Subtenancy of Same or Longer Term or of Superior Tenancy. If the regulated tenancy is derived from another tenancy or what is known as superior tenancy, and the term of such tenancy must expire at the same time as or on a day later than the expiry of the term, in paragraphs 13 and 14 of our reply to the legal advisor, dated July the 28th, we have addressed the issue. We understand that in the SU market, subtenancy is rather prevalent. 120AO stipulates that the tenure of a regulated tenancy is fixed at 2 years, but if a tenancy is a subtenancy, or if a regulated tenancy is a subtenancy, the tenure of the subtenancy might be the same as the tenure of the superior tenancy. And that means the remaining tenancy in the or tenure of the superior tenancy is less than or equal to 2 years. According to the common law jurisdiction of Hong Kong, what would be the effects of the provision? According to the Melmo principle, for the sub-landlord, in the superior tenancy signed between the sub-landlord and the superior landlord, the remainder of the tenancy would be transferred to the subtenant, and that would not constitute a tenancy between both. So the sub-landlord will no longer be the landlord of the tenant. If this occurs in a regulated tenancy, it would not be appropriate in our opinion, since it would lead to confusion between the roles of the sub-landlord and tenant. Very often, the superior landlord would not agree with subletting of the premises by the sublandlord. So when the sublandlord sublets part of all of the premises to the subtenant, while the contract between the sublandlord has superior landlord has 2 or more years remaining, then the superior landlord would reluctantly become the landlord of a tertiary tenant. So we suggest that the common law principles would not apply to the regulated tenancy. If a regulated tenancy appears to be created out of a superior tenancy, even if the remainder of the superior tenancy is less than or equals to 2 years, the tenancy would not be transferred to the subtenant. Please move on. Subsection 3 stipulates that with the common law principles not in application, what the term of the regulated tenancy would expire. And if the term of the regulated tenancy is to expire no longer than expiry of the term of the superior tenancy, and without limiting subsection 5, the provision would apply. And subsection 5 stipulates that if the term of the superior tenancy is extended or renewed by the superior landlord, the expiry of the term of the regulated tenancy would then be earlier of the following: A, the expiry of the term of the superior tenancy as extended or renewed, or B, the expiry of the term of the regulated tenancy. Please continue. We now go back to subsection 4. Subsection 4 provides that subsection 3 does not affect any remedy that the subtenant may have for the revision of the term of the regulated tenancy. Mr. Tony Chair. Chairman. Can the subtenant know about the tenure of the sublandlord or the tenure of the agreement signed with the landlord? Does the subtenant have such right? Normally, when the subtenant signs an agreement, he or she should find out whether the tenure is adequate under the superior tenancy. Of course, the subtenant can ask this question, but if the sublandlord refuses to answer the question, what would happen? And the agreement must receive a stamp, and could the subtenant find out about the situation with the sublandlord? Apart from doing a search on the register, well, if the sublandlord does not disclose the information, how can the subtenant obtain such information? In the bill as proposed, there is no mandatory requirement on the sublandlord to disclose their agreement with the superior landlord. Normally, the subtenant can ask the sublandlord. Even if the superior tenancy has a shorter tenure than the subtenancy tenure, Very often, there is a discrepancy between the tenors of both. But unless the sub-landlord has an intent to deceive, even if the tenure of the superior tenancy is shorter, it could be consistently renewed. So there won't be any issues. So if the tenure of the superior tenancy is shorter than the tenure of the sub-tenancy, that might not present a problem, since the superior tenancy could be constantly renewed. But according to the bill, if this does happen, the common law principle or Milmo principle would be disapplied. If the superior tenancy could not be renewed and that the subtenancy must be terminated, are there any remedies? We provide that the superior landlord must provide another 60 days for the tenant to find another accommodation. So later we would get to that provision. Chairman, the subtenant might not know about the tenure of the tenancy or their position, and they, in the worst case scenario, they might have to move out at 60 days' notice. There is a lot of concern on the tenants of SEUs. So the rent control regime is rather problematic in this regard. And that is the tenor of the agreement might not be as simple as 2+2. There has always been concern between the roles of the superior landlord, sub-landlord, and tenant. So I believe we can visit this at a later stage. Mr. Kwai-kang, basically the subtenant knows very little, except that they are paying very high rents. For the superior tenancy, very often the subtenant knows very little about it. So basically, the tenor of the superior tenancy would be the deciding factor, and the tenor of the subtenancy could be shortened accordingly. The sublandlord would only inform the subtenant if the sublandlord intends to invoke this provision. That is, the tenancy would be less than 2 years, but the issue would be rather complex. If the discrepancy in tenors is only 1 or 2 months, it might not be a problem. But if the difference is as much as a year, then things would be much more complicated for the subtenant. Are we going to require the sublandlord to proactively inform the subtenant that the tenancy is a subtenancy, and the sublandlord must tell the subtenant the remaining tenure on the superior tenancy? So the sublandlord should proactively disclose such information, or else the subtenant would expect the full tenor to be met. And if the sublandlord does not disclose the information, the subtenant would not be in the know. Is there any provision requiring the sublandlord to proactively disclose the information? Undersecretary, this is a rather common concern by subtenants. If the sublandlord does invoke the provision, what kind of proof must be produced to show that the regulated tenancy must be terminated early, instead of asking the subtenants to solicit the information? Thank you. Undersecretary, thank you very much. Under the bill, we do not require the sublandlord to declare the tenor of the superior tenancy. Instead, the subtenant should protect themselves by asking for such information before signing the agreement. Subtenancy is now very common among SEUs.
Well, theoretically speaking, when you want to rent a unit, you want to know everything about it, but why are rents of SEU so high? Because they are much sought after in the market, and if you inquire more, perhaps you will not be able to rent the SDU. Maybe it's not proper to require the subtenant to ask for information. Is there any responsibility for them to disclose the information to a subtenant? Well, the current legislation doesn't require the tenants to provide information of the superior tenancy. So if you want to invoke this section, how much advance notice should be given to the subtenant? 1 year, half a year, 9 months, or 31 days? Well, the notice will have to be posted at the door, and it will be 60 days after the notice. So there should be sufficient time for the subtenant to find an alternative accommodation. My understanding is that this is close to an exemption clause here. You need to accord different treatment, and the enforcement should not be the same with our other situations. Now, the tenant knows well beforehand, so he should be in a position to inform the subtenant earlier. He should not wait until the last minute, because he should have known earlier. Now, I think that this is already happening. Now, for the tenant, he will have this 2 plus 2 years tenure with the landlord. The tenants may only be aware of the fact that he cannot get a tenancy renewal at the last minute. So if we make it compulsory for the tenant to inform his subtenant before a certain time, that may not be practical. So the solution is, now, first, theoretically speaking, the subtenancy would end at the expiry of the superior tenancy. On the same day, the two tenancies will expire. Now, by then, the landlord of the regulated tenancy will no longer have any role to play. So the landlord will have to make an application to the court for the subtenant to move out. As I said, usually it takes about 4 to 5 months for the proceedings. So, if the court approves the recovery of the SDU by the landlord, then a notice will have to be posted at the door of the SDU for 3 days. And that is a formal notice. Then it will be a few months after. And then after the notice has been posted, there will be another 60 days. You can call it a grace period. During that period, the landlord cannot recover the unit during that period. So it will be around half a year or even more for the affected subtenant to find another SDU. So we believe this is a more practical remedy and will help subtenants of SDUs to cope so that they will not be evicted at short notice and made homeless. There will be a few months for the subtenant to seek alternative accommodation. Can the administration please clarify? Must the first tenant move out first, or can the sub-landlord require the sub-tenant to leave? Or is it that the after the sub-landlord is no longer there, it will be for the landlord to do the rest? Now, under common law, when the superior tenancy has expired, then the sub-tenancy would lapse automatically at once. Now, the administration said that the landlord may not know that the tenant would sublet his SDU. And I think there is another context, and that is the landlord doesn't manage his tenancies. Rather, a tenant is asked to do it on his behalf. Will the following happen? It's a possible abuse. The sublandlord knows full well that the superior tenancy and the subtenancies do not synchronize. Yet they still rent out the SDUs. Technically, there may be some problem with the expiry of a superior tenancy. Now, if the landlord or the superior landlord uses this approach, then that will cost him a few months and even up to half a year. So this is not really a practical way of doing business. So I don't think this will be a common phenomenon. Yes, I understand the Undersecretary's point, but our concerns are not really allayed. If the superior landlord deliberately use staggered tenancies together with the sub-landlord, then a sub-tenancy may not have a complete 2 years term. Yes, I think I have heard of such concerns. And we will consider subsection 6. The sub-landlord is treated as having a reversion expectant on the regulated tenancy, even though the term of the regulated tenancy expires at the same time as the expiry of the term of the superior tenancy. All right. Yes, please continue. Now we go to section 120AAZB. tenant's interest to pass to family members on death. Subsection 1, or rather, the section allows the subsisting benefits and protection under the regulating tenancy to which the tenant is entitled under this part during the tenant's lifetime, after the tenant's death, available to the family members. And for definition, please refer to the definition on page 0005. So family members would mean the spouse, the children, and parents. And in paragraph 15 of our letter, in response to the legal advisor's letter, now we're talking about adult children and also succeeding children. And this is similar to the reference in section 115A. So if need be, we can add some provisions to make it clearer. Well, members may want to consider under the administration, children would include children born out of the wedlock and adopted children and also stepchildren. Any question here? Mrs. Regina Yip. Spouse, those properly wedded. I'd like to know whether partners are included. Now, what does a spouse include? What about a partner? Partners are excluded. Same-sex partner excluded as well, right? Spouse of a legitimate marriage. Yes. We agree. Administration, please consider making it clearer here. So we have completed Division 3. We can now go to Division 4, Rents and Deposit, Subdivision 1, General Provisions. Section 120AAZC, Rental Deposit. Prohibits the charging of a rental deposit of more than 2 months' rent, and then it should be returned to the tenant no later than the time specified in subsection 4. Yes, please go on. If there are no questions, we can go to 120AAZD, alteration in rent. During the regulated tenancy, the rent cannot be altered. But then, the landlord may downwardly adjust the rent during the regulated tenancy or any subsequent agreement. So, the landlord is allowed to lower the rent. Yes. Now, subdivision 2, renewed rent. Section 120AAZE. Here it sets out a mechanism to work out the maximum rent payable upon renewal of a tenancy. Now, the maximum percentage for an increase of rent for the second term tenancy is to be the lower of the formula set out here, or 15%. And and it means the figure of the rental index of the fourth calendar month immediately before the commencement month of the purported second term tenancy that is prevailing on the first day of the offer period. And then we are comparing the difference in index between the index at the start of the tenancy and the first day of the commencement of the next tenancy. Now, according to 120AS, the landlord will have to during the offer period, and that is 2 months prior to the start of a second term tenancy, make an offer to the tenant for a second term tenancy. And then the rent must be set out according to the form required here, for instance. Now, if the bill takes effect on the 1st of January 2022, then the first month of the tenancy will be the 1st of January. And then the tenancy will end on the 31st of December 2023. And the second term tenancy will start on the 1st of January 2024. And then the offer must be made within November 2023 and to inform the tenant what will be the new rent. Now, the C in formula will be the rental index as at January 2022, and then B will be the index as at September 2023. And the RNVD will first publish the rent index 3 days prior to the end of October 2023. And then the rent index will be the 1st of November 2023.
If the control percentage is a negative figure, the rents for the second term tenancy must be lowered at least by the same percentage, but the landlord can lower the rent by a larger percentage compared with the control percentage. This has to do with the extent of the rent increase is capped at 15, according to the rental index published by the Rating and Valuation Department. If the control percentage is negative, then rent must be reduced as well. Will the index be published every October? The rental index of a particular month would be published for the first time at the end of the next month. Some members propose amendments. Hopefully, they could be considered by the administration. So that's all for Division 5. We now move on to Division 5, implied terms. Section 120 AAZF. The provisions in Schedule 7 are to be impliedly incorporated into every regulated tenancy, including a tenancy agreed orally, and this is binding on both the tenant and landlord. If the incorporated provisions are not in line with the agreement, then the incorporated provisions would prevail. Please continue. We can first scrutinize Schedule 7. This is at page 0064 of the marked up copy. Schedule 7. Mandatory terms implied for every regulated tenancy. There are four parts to Schedule 7. Part 1, interpretation. This is rather straightforward, so I won't go into the details. The interpretation of terms are from Section 120AA2. Part 2, tenancy agreement. For the stamp duty, it must be borne solely by the landlord. 3. The landlord must, after receiving the tenancy agreement for a regulated tenancy signed by the tenant, cause the tenancy agreement to be stamped and within 30 days return to the tenant a counterpart of the stamped tenancy agreement signed by the parties. Section 4 stipulates that if the landlord fails to do so, the tenant may withhold the payment of rent until the landlord has done so. If the landlord has eventually returned the counterpart of the agreement to the tenant, the tenant must pay back free of interest any rent withheld to the landlord within 15 days. If the tenant fails to comply with this requirement, the landlord may, by giving the tenant not less than 15 days of notice in writing, terminate the tenancy. Part 3, landlord's obligations during term. Section 5, maintenance and repair. On receiving a notice from the tenant for repair of an item, the landlord must carry out the repair as soon as practicable. Mr. Tony Chair, I'd like to ask about the issue of repairs. If, in case of any dispute on the obligation to conduct repairs, what would be the treatment? Can the tenant carry out the repairs for themselves? If the requests for repairs are allowed to drag on, the tenants might suffer. If demands for repairs are ignored, the tenancy could be terminated. Let's say if the landlord threatens to terminate the tenancy due to any issues that might be unfair to the tenant. As for the proper working order of fixtures and fittings, what do they actually refer to? I think there should be a clear arrangement for the sake of fairness. Section 6 allows the tenant to terminate the tenancy under certain scenarios. Normally, the tenant would carry out the repairs themselves before recovering the costs from the landlord. If the landlord refuses to pay the costs, the tenant may recover the costs through legal proceedings. If the sum is less than $75,000, the sum could be pursued at the small claims tribunal. Subsection 5.2, the fixtures and fittings refer to things that are permanently installed, such as water, heaters, air conditioners, etc. These are examples of fixtures and fittings. Can this be elaborated on? Because some tenants might not have a very clear idea what they refer to. If you ask them to go to the small claims tribunal, it would not be very convenient for tenants. So what kind of safeguards are in place for tenants? If you have to go through the small claims tribunal, the proceedings would take time and the tenancy could not yet be terminated. If the landlord frequently refuses to carry out repairs, depending on the circumstances, it could be a breach of the offense under 120AAZN, because the tenant might be seen as refusing to provide services as reasonably expected, and we believe this would serve a deterrent effect. Any other questions, Mr. Wilson Orr? I'd like to go back to part one of Schedule 7. We receive complaints from some tenants that they have been treated unfairly at the Legislative Council. We received a complaint that a tenant did not know that the premises were part of a staff quarters. Under part one of Schedule 7, there is a definition of regulated tenancy. Can this be further clarified? If the tenant does not know that the premises are a part of a staff quarters, and if they rent the premises, they would not receive the safeguard. So could this be clarified? In terms of the definition of a regulated tenancy, this is in line with the definition under Section 120A. A regulated tenancy refers to a tenancy that is applicable under the new Part 4A. The administration indicated that legal proceedings could be taken out if there are issues. If the landlord refuses to do certain things, they might commit an offense. But very often, the point of contention lies in whether proper use is constituted. For SDUs, water leakage is a common problem, and if they are caused by a drainage block, would that be interpreted as proper use? And in case of water leakage, sometimes it is caused by the unit upstairs. So this is a rather complicated issue. Of course, the tenant can carry out the repairs themselves, but there is a cost to be paid. When the task force look at the situation with SDUs, did they consider the fact that landlords should have the responsibility to carry out certain repairs? For instance, if someone uses corrosive liquid to clear drainage blocks, who would be held responsible? Very often, SDUs are under repair or under maintained. So, would the state of maintenance of the SDU be considered? What would be the standards adopted by the Lands Tribunal in assessing responsibility of repairs? You argued against the idea of initial rents due to a lack of information. So in terms of the responsibility of conducting repairs, would it be based on premises or units that are in a good state of repair? I wonder whether, I hope I have expressed myself properly. When the task force conducted the study, they looked at the issues of maintenance and repair, and indeed this is a challenging issue, and there are different types of SDUs on the market, and they might be in vastly different conditions. Some are rather well maintained, some aren't. So if we are to draw a standard on what a satisfactory level of maintenance is, it might not be easy. As for the issue of water seepage, it's also difficult to ascertain the responsibility. So when we draft Section 5 on the obligations involved with maintenance and repair, we must be very careful because we don't want to impose undue obligations on the landlord. That is why we adopted recommendations of the task force. If we are to impose obligations of maintenance and repair on the landlord, we must clearly define the items they should be responsible for. That is why we have included some provisions under Section 5. What about the level of maintenance? Is there a standard? Of course, there are different ways to maintain a unit. If you do not take it seriously, the unit might need another maintenance job very soon. If you rent new premises, of course, everything would be in order. But when it comes to SDUs, some of them are in rather poor conditions.
Well, that's acceptable. But maybe it will break down a few days after repair, and then again and again, and then it's troublesome. Yes, please note our concern. Well, I did touch on Section 6. That is, if the landlord fails to fulfill an obligation in the Section 5 of the schedule, then the tenant may, by giving the landlord not less than 30 days of prior notice and writing, terminate the tenancy. So I think at most, the tenant can leave, and this is not really a protection for the tenant. Please go on, part 4. Tenant's obligations during term. Sections 7 to 11 sets out the obligations of the tenant. That will include the tenant must pay the rent to the landlord on or before the due date, and no structural alteration without the consent of the landlord, and the tenant must not use the premises for any immoral or illegal purpose, and the tenant must not do anything that would cause annoyance or inconvenience or disturbance to the landlord or any other person, and there can be no sublenting, sublenting without the prior approval of the landlord. And now, Mr. Tony C, part 7. It's about penalties, rent and penalties. Now, the rent. Usually, is inclusive of rent of rates. The obligation to pay rates is on the landlord, and the landlord cannot require the subtenant to pay the increase in rates because of a change in the rateable value. Is that correct? There is nothing in the bill to require either the landlord or the tenant to pay rates. If I'm correct, the RNVD can correct me. But in most cases, it will be for the landlord to pay rates. And so usually the rent is inclusive of rates. And if the rates are increased during tenancy term, the landlord cannot raise rent as a result. The reason I talked about this is because of subdivision 7 says that it is an offense. You have included things the landlord can recover or payment the landlord can recover from the tenant, but then rates is not a kind of service. Because the rates, any adjustment in rates can go up or go down, this will have nothing to do with the tenant. Is that correct? Yes, to put it simply, under no circumstances can a landlord raise rent during the tenancy period. If there is any downward adjustment in rates, the landlord can lower the rent, but he cannot raise it. But he can choose not to lower the rent as a result. Indeed, so the rent is fixed. 12. If the tenant has not paid rent within 15 days after the due date, and if the tenant is in breach of Section 8 to 11, then the landlord can re-enter the premises. All right, can we return to the earlier provisions? Can we go back to 120AZG? Is 31, page 31. The secretary may, by notice published in the Gazette, amend Schedule 7. So we've completed Subdivision 5. Or Division 5, we can go to Division 6, Termination of Tenancy. Section 120AAZH, Early Termination by Tenant. This section allows a tenant to terminate a tenancy within any period after 1 year, 1 year after the start of the tenancy. Yes, please go on. So Section 120AAZI is the landlord's right of re-entry. A landlord of a regulated tenancy for a subdivided unit must not terminate the tenancy before the expiry of the term. But if then the landlord may terminate the tenancy by notice in accordance with Section 120AAZ7 or Section 43 of Part 2 of Schedule 7 impliedly incorporated into the tenancy under Section 120AAZF. Okay. Then can we go to 120AAZJ? Termination of a regulated tenancy as a subtenancy. Now this section says out that now if a regulated tenancy for a subtenancy unit is a subtenancy control or created out of another tenancy, and a superior landlord applies to the court for possession of the subdivided unit, then before enforcing any order of the court for possession of the subdivided unit, the superior landlord must notify the tenant of the regulated tenancy in writing in the way specified in subsection 3, and that the landlord must on 3 successive days post a notice on the main door or entrance to the SDU. However, if the subdivided unit has been delivered for vacant possession, then this is an exemption. We believe this arrangement will give sufficient time to subtenants to find a alternative accommodation. All right, this is about approval by the court. Yes? If this is okay, we have completed Division 6. We can move on to Division 7. Offences relating to regulated tenancy. Section 120AAZNK, offence in relation to tenants' payment of money other than certain types. Now, if a tenant of a regulated tenancy requires the tenant to pay or the landlord otherwise the following: specified rents, specified rental deposits, reimbursement of charges for any of the specified utilities and services payable by the tenant under the tenancy, or damages for the tenant's breach of the tenancy, commits an offense. Or if he tries to charge the tenant on items other than the four categories I just mentioned, then he commits an offense. And what about sewage or domestic waste disposal charge? It is not covered here. Now, if in future MSW charge has start charging has started and is not in the tenancy, what will happen? Well, I think you have to think about that. It will be about time. It will be some time before a charging commences. Now, if the landlord is responsible for buying the designated bags and paying the MSW charges, how can that be recovered? Well, when we were considering the bill, there were various views from the administration. What about laundry costs? And the landlord may also think of various strange services in order to charge the tenant. The spirit of Section 120AAZK is in response to feedback or comments we received from the community, and that is the landlord would make up all sorts of excuses to charge different fees. For instance, the rent may just be a few thousand dollars, but then the landlord can charge the tenant a lot for other strange services. Now, it is reasonable for the landlord to recover the MSW charges, but here we have specified four different types of charges. For instance, utilities apportioned and damages for the tenant's breach of the tenancy, the landlord can claim the tenant for these. Now, for other fees and charges under this bill, they are not allowed. That will include future MSW charges. Then the landlord will have to reflect the MSW charges in the rent. So the rent should include foreseeable fees and charges to be borne by the landlord. So the landlord must not sign a tenancy agreement with a tenant first, only to claim him for other expenses later. And this is in response to comments in the community that the landlords are charging for various strange services. Mr. Tony Z. Now, in C, there are two factors. First, specified. Specified. Theoretically speaking, they should be included in the tenancy, or can that be added later? And secondly, reimbursement. That is, things the landlord has paid for first, and to seek a reimbursement from the tenants. For instance, if the total cost is $10, it will have to be apportioned among three tenants. This is my understanding of the provision here. The provision is quite clear here. The landlord can only charge these types of money. Otherwise, he commits an offense. And What about repair and maintenance? Sometimes a repair item may involve a few subdivided units. For instance, the problem in this SDU was caused by the SDU next door. Now, does that mean that the landlord cannot seek a reimbursement from the SEU for such repair fees? Now, for specified utilities in 120AA, we have got a definition. We are referring to a water, a gas, or electricity, or telecommunication services, such as internet and a fixed line and other services. So these are the specified utilities.
Secondly, in terms of the reimbursement of fees for specified utilities, these are fees paid by the landlord, and they could recover such fees from the tenants. But according to 120AAZL, the cost could only be recovered under certain circumstances. Mr. Chair referred to the costs for repairs for the whole building to be borne by the landlords. According to 120AAZK, such fees could not be recovered from the tenants. For specified utilities, there is a certain definition, and such interpretation must be adopted rather than the common interpretation. For charges for agreed services or facilities, could they not be included in the regulated tenancy? So there is already a definition for specified utilities and services. Is that right? Yes. Subsection 3 provides that for an offense under subsection 1, the mistaken belief of the person charged as to the money the person is entitled or permitted to receive is not a defense. In our reply to the legal advisor and to the chairman, we pointed out that 120AZK1, the offense is an absolute liability offense, so no defense is provided, and the person being charged could not use the defense that there is a mistaken belief. And since the situation of overcharging of tenants is rather serious, we are providing an absolute liability offense in order to protect the tenants. Any other questions? Okay, please move on. We now move on to Section 120AAZL, offense in relation to payment of apportioned amounts. This section applies if the charges for any of the specified utilities and services for an SDU incurred by a tenant or a regulated tenancy for the SDU are not independently billed by the relevant authorities or service providers. If the landlord does not satisfy all these conditions and requests reimbursement of charges from the tenant, it would be an offense. And these conditions include the fact that the landlord is the payer named in the bills covering the charges. B, copies of the bills are produced by the landlord to the tenant when the landlord requires payment. And C, the landlord has provided an account in writing to the tenant showing how the amounts under the bills are apportioned for the different parts and that the aggregate of the apportioned amounts does not exceed the bill amounts. And if the landlord commits an offense, if the landlord requires the tenant to pay for or the landlord otherwise receives from the tenant the reimbursement of the charges for any of the specified utilities and services for the SDU at a sum exceeding the apportioned amount for the subdivided units as shown in the account. Please go on. And like the offense under 120 AAZK, subsections 2 and 3 to section 120 AAZL are also absolute liability offenses. We now move on to section 120 AAZN, offense in relation to provision of rent receipts. In terms of reimbursement of charges, the landlord must provide written accounts of the bills. So the receipts must be produced to the tenant. The tenant has a right to request the bills to be produced. If the bills could not be produced, is the tenant entitled to not pay the fees? There are three conditions. The landlord must be the payer named in the bills covering the charges. Second, copies of the bills must be produced by the landlord to the tenant. And three, the landlord has provided an account in writing showing how the amounts under the bills are apportioned. Let's say if the water bill amounts to $100, how is the $100 apportioned among different tenants? All three criteria must be met before the landlord can request reimbursement of fees from the tenant. Otherwise, it is an offense. In other words, the landlord must pay the fees first. There could be a time gap between the landlord paying the fees and reimbursement by the tenants. The landlord does not necessarily have to pay the bill before requesting reimbursement. In other words, the landlord can ask for reimbursement before actually paying the bill. So what if the landlord does not actually pay the bill? Well, the common interpretation for reimbursement is that fees already paid should be recovered. Does it mean that the reimbursement can be requested before actually paying the bills? Yes. We now move on to section 120 AAZM, offense in relation to provision of rent receipts. Subsection 1 provides that a landlord of a regulated tenancy must give a receipt to a tenant within 7 days after receiving the amount. this is similar to Section 190RA. A receipt must be given to the tenant, but as for fees for utilities and services, no receipt needs to be produced to the tenant, right? Yes, we do not have such requirement in place. Please move on. Section 120AAZN, offense of harassment. If a person unlawfully deprives a tenant of a regulated tenancy for a subdivided unit of occupation of the subdivided unit, the person commits an offense too. If any acts calculated to interfere with the peace or comfort of the tenant or members of the tenant's household, or persistently withdraws or withholds services reasonably required for occupation of the SU as a dwelling, and if a person knows or has reasonable cause to believe that the conduct is likely to cause the tenant to give up occupation of the SCU or refrain from exercising any right or pursuing any remedy in respect of the subdivided unit, the person commits an offense. On a first conviction, a person who commits an offense is liable to a fine of $500,000 and to imprisonment for 12 months, and on a second or subsequent conviction to a fine of $1 million and to imprisonment for 3 years. And the person convicted might have to pay to the tenant a sum that the court considers appropriate. And this is similar to Cap Movement 9. We now move on to Section 8, and there are four subdivisions. Subdivision 1, interpretation. Subdivision 2, commissioner's certificate. And the interpretation includes the definitions of premises and primary user certificate. Please continue. Section 2, for the purposes of this division, a reference to the commissioner includes, as the case requires, an RVD officer authorized in writing in that behalf by the commissioner to exercise any of the powers conferred or perform any of the duties imposed on the commissioner for the purposes of this part. Subdivision 2, commissioner's certificate. And this is in reference to Section 74115, Section 120AZP, application for primary user certificate. Whether the tenancy is a domestic tenancy, the landlord or tenant can lodge an application to the commissioner for the issue of a primary user certificate for the premises. Section 120AZQ, commissioner's inspection. Before the commissioner issues a primary user certificate for the premises, the commissioner can carry out an inspection for the purpose of determining the primary user or the premises. We now move on to Section 120AZR, commissioner's issue of primary user certificate. This empowers the commissioner, after carrying out any inspection of any premises under Section 120AZQ, if satisfied on the evidence available as to the primary user of the premises, issue and serve on the landlord and tenant a primary user certificate as to the primary user of the premises on the day of the inspection. We now move on to Subdivision 3, Commissioner's Endorsement. 120AAZS, Notice of Tenancy to Commissioner. The landlord of a first-term and second-term tenancy must submit a notice in the specified form to the commissioner to notify the commissioner of the particulars of the tenancy. If the landlord, without reasonable excuse, refuses or neglects to comply with subsection 2, the landlord commits an offence punishable on conviction to a fine at level 3, and in the case of a continuing offence, to a further fine of $200 for each day during which the offence continues. The proposed offence is to allow the RVD to collect timely information on rents on the market and to enhance market transparency and allow the government to assess the effectiveness of the rent control measures. Please move on. Section 120 AAZT, Commissioner's Endorsement of Notice of Tenancy. This provides that the commissioner is obliged to endorse the notice with the date of its receipt and notify the landlord and tenant of the receipt of the notice. Unless the relevant notice is endorsed by the commissioner, the landlord may not maintain an action to recover any rent under the tenancy. And this is in line with Section 74119L.
Please continue. So we've completed subsection subdivision 3. We move on to subdivision 4, Section 120 AAZU. Commissioner may service requisition. Now, the commissioner may serve on any person a requisition in a specified form, and the person must, within the period specified by the commissioner in writing, provide to the commissioner particulars required by the requisition. The person, without reasonable excuse, refuses or neglects to comply with succession to commits an offence. This is the same as Section 119G and Section 119U. So we move on to Section 120 AAZV. Commissioner may require reference documents. Subsection 1. The commissioner may require the landlord or tenant of any premises for the purpose of this part to provide any reference document to the commissioner, and the landlord and tenant has to provide the reference document as required by the commissioner during the specified period. If the provider, with a reasonable excuse, refuses or neglects to comply with this request, commits an offence. This is similar to Section 119A, 119G1, and also 119U1. 120AAZW, Commissioner may enter premises with consent. Now, it may be for the purpose of inspection of the premises or to confirm the main use of the premises. Second, to ascertain whether an offence under this part, that is 4A, is being or has been committed in relation to the premises. Yes. We can consider 1AA, 120AAZX and 120AAYZ together, and that is commissioner may enter premises with a warrant. Now for subsection 1, the commissioner is empowered to enter premises for the purposes mentioned in section 120AAZY. Now if the commissioner is for the purpose of section 120AAW, or if he is impeded or obstructed in that way when trying to enter premises, then he may apply for warrant and to enter these premises for these purposes. And if the commissioner has the warrant from a magistrate, then he can enter premises. And then he can exercise any of the powers specified in section 120AAYZ1 and 2, and in subsection 3, 120AAZX, we can see conditions under which a warrant can be issued. Now, if it is for determination of the primary use of the premises, and then the warrant has to be enforced within a reasonable period of time, and the commissioner may also be accompanied by any person for the purpose of entry to a premises. Now, many tenants are saying that if there is anything illegal, a warrant can be handed down for entry into premises for inspection. Yes, under this bill, that is possible. Yes, please go on. And Section 120A, is that why? Subsection 1 and 2. For the purpose of entering the premises, for the purpose 128A(x) 1 and 2, now the commissioner will have the following powers. Well, for instance, to inspect and search the premises, to examine any document, to take any measurements, or to take any photograph or video recording, or to seize and detain anything for exercise of his powers and duties. Now we can go to Section 120AAZZ. The commissioner may disclose information. Under this section, the commissioner is authorized to disclose information sought under Section 128A. Now, for the compliance of this ordinance, for the rating ordinance, CAP 115, and the government rent assessment and collection ordinance, CAP 515, or to perform a function imposed on the person. This is similar to Section 120AAY, Subsection 1 and 2. Okay, please go on. We've completed Division 8. We now go to Division 9, the last one. Mr. Tony C. Regarding the commissioners, and a primary user certificate. Is it that within a 1 year, a certificate has been issued? A new one cannot be required. That is under 120AAZR. Yes, this is similar to the current arrangement under R and VD and the spirit is, if a landlord or tenant has applied for that certificate, of course, we don't want a new application to the REVD be made within a short period of time. Because, as mentioned in the bill, the commissioner has to inspect the premises first and so there are things for the commissioner to do. This is to prevent abuse. But if such an application comes with justification, although it is within that 1 year, the commissioner can still request another inspection. Is that allowed? Or is it that within 1 year, no application can be entertained? RNVD. Well, we enforce the ordinance according to the provisions as set by my colleague. We have to inspect the premises which are occupied, and we want to prevent abuse and not to cause a disturbance to tenants, because the landlord can also make such an application. If we're too liberal, then that may be an annoyance to tenants. Noted, but is there any such a power? According to the law, it would be not allowed within 1 year. So, but does the commissioner has any power? Even though with good justifications, the commissioner is not allowed to do it. Well, we will follow. We will strictly adhere to the ordinance. My answer is it yes or no? Yes. So the commissioner has no power. He has no power to inspect the primary use of the premises within 1 year. You're correct. Well, upon enactment of the bill, what is your plan? Will you have dedicated manpower to conduct, for instance, investigations? We will arrange for manpower to carry out the powers enjoyed by the commissioner here. So we'll ensure that the provisions can be effectively enforced. All right, please, we'll go back to subsection Division 9, 120AAZZA. This is about cost of proceedings under this part. The court must not make any order as to costs against a party unless that party has conducted a case in a frivolous or vexatious manner. This is very similar to section 119A. All right, we move on to section 128AZZB, giving evidence in proceedings. This would allow the commissioner or any person of officer employed by RNVD to give evidence in proceedings before the court. However, the court can summons the commissioner or an RVD officer to give evidence in any proceedings before the court for determining whether or not tenancy is in domestic tenancy for the purpose of this section. And this is similar to section 119, subsection 9. Now, 120AAZZC, use of returned requisition as evidence. Now, returned requisition is in any proceedings before the tribunal or magistrate, the district court, or the court of appointed appeal admissible as evidence. And this is for, and this includes a notice submitted to the commissioner under section 128AZS2 or requisition served under 128AZU1 on a person or served under section 51A of the rating ordinance on a person who is the owner or occupier of a treatment or served under section 31(1)(a) of the government rent assessment and collection ordinance. On a person who is the lessee of an applicable lease or the owner occupier of a tenant and returned by the person to the commissioner containing or in any of the particulars required to be given by the person to the commissioner. This is similar to section 119GA. Yes, please go on. Section 120AAZZD, providing false or misleading particulars. Under this provision, anyone who provides a misleading or a false particulars under this section or make a misleading and a false representations in a material particular or provides any reference document that is false or misleading in a material particular or says or states anything that is false or misleading in a material particular, or who knows that, or is reckless, or to whether or not a particular reference document or information is false or misleading, then he commits an offense and is liable on conviction to a fine at level 3 and to imprisonment for 3 months. The fine has been raised from level 2 to level 3 and imprisonment for 3 months. And the penalty is on a par with those under 120AZZU and G. And this is about not providing the evidence or documents required by the commissioner. So you have raised the penalty. Section 120AAZZE, use of incriminating evidence in proceedings. Now, in legal proceedings, what if incriminating evidence is used? I need some time to explain this clause to you. Now, in subsection 2, when the commissioner serves a statement to any person, then the relevant person will have to provide particulars required in the return within a reasonable period of time. If a person without reasonable excuse refuses or refuses without any good justification to provide such information, commits an offense. And that could include regulated tenancies. And a person is not excused from complying with the requirement imposed on the person under Section 120AAZUE, only on the ground that to do so might lead to incriminate the person, and that may undermine a person's privilege not to incriminate himself. Although this is not absolute, we have to ensure this. So under subsection 3, it is stated that if the conditions specified in subsection 4 are satisfied, and that is the person's response might tend to incriminate himself, or that the person so claims before giving the response, then the commissioner's requirement and the person's responses are not admissible in evidence under the present criminal procedure.
So Section 2 specifies that the commissioner must ensure that the requisition served on the person contains sufficient information to inform and remind the person of the limitations imposed by Subsection 3. As for whether a person commits an offense under 120AAZU through the response, that is failure to furnish the particulars. And the provision of false or misleading particulars, according to the relevant offenses of making of false evidence under Part 5 of the Crimes Ordinance Cap 200, these would affect whether a person is liable. So this would hamper the effective discharge of the duties of the commissioner in regulating SDUs. So subsection 6 provides that if a person is charged with an offense in respect of the person's response, the relevant information or the relevant information could be admissible in evidence against the person in criminal proceedings. Any questions? We now move on to 120AZZF forms. This empowers the commissioner to specify the forms to be used under this part. These forms are not part of subsidiary legislation, and this is similar to Section 74119F. Please continue. Section 120AAZZG, service of documents. This provides for matters under the new Part 4A. These are rather straightforward. And these provisions are similar to Section 74119I. On the service of documents, there are different methods. Normally, which method is adopted to serve documents? Under subsection 1C, there are two parts, 1 and 2, on the service of documents on a tenant. For subsections 1C, 1 and 2, which option is more common in terms of the service of documents to our documents. You asked about which approach is currently more common for service of documents under Part 4. Due to the pandemic, more people prefer an electronic method in submission, but in some cases, documents are also mailed in or delivered in person. What about service of documents on the tenants? The approach of service is up to them. For documents we serve on the tenants, according to Part 4, we would serve Form CR-109 under Section 119L on the tenants. For Form CR-109, once the form is endorsed, it will be mailed back to the tenant. Yes, since this is a hard copy of the document, so it will be mailed back to the tenant. There are two ways to serve documents on tenants. Which approach would you adopt? We would mail the documents. Apparently, this is not an option here. Assistant Commissioner. Subsection 1C2 refers to documents served on the tenant by the landlord. A copy would be affixed, but if there is any document we need to serve on the tenant, we would use post under subsection 1B. This refers to the service of specified documents by different parties, including from landlord to tenant, tenant to landlord, commissioner to tenant, tenant to landlord, or tenant to commissioner, etc. So this covers different scenarios. Subsections 1, A, B, C should be read together. If any document is to be served on a tenant, these two options could be used. But it does not mean that options A and B cannot be used. And likewise, if the commissioner is to serve documents, they can choose option A, B, or C. My concern is on the service of documents from the commissioner. I see two options. I think you should have a more definite plan now. In terms of affixing a copy of the document to a prominent part of the premises, we had reservations on this arrangement since the document could be lost. As to whether this is a suitable arrangement, we have expressed our concerns in other legislation. It's either this or that. So it's important to serve the documents on the right recipients, since there could be deadlines, and in some cases a response is needed. So hopefully the documents can be served to the due recipients. That is why I asked this question. So apparently there are different options, but for documents served by the commissioner, apparently you don't have a plan yet. Of course, it might depend on the circumstances. But if affixing a copy of the document is one option, I wonder whether it's appropriate since we are dealing with SDUs. The time is now 4:25, and we have reached CAP 120A SSHG, and the next section would be interpretation. So if members see fit, we would extend the meeting by 15 minutes, and if we are not done yet, we can continue at the next meeting. If we see the tenant during our visit, we might hand over the document to someone on site to ensure that the tenant would receive the document. Mr. Wilson, all. I have a question as well on the service of documents. Documents could be served in different ways. Would we consider using double registered mail as one of the options? You said documents could be handed over in person at the site, and in some cases a copy could be affixed, but we saw that that might not be an effective way to serve the document. So can we clarify the arrangement or service of documents to ensure that the tenants can receive these very important documents? Thank you very much. The arrangement is similar to section 119Y. Under subsections 1A, B, and C, these are ways documents could be served. For the purpose of this part, different parties can choose to deliver or serve the documents by personal service. Subsection 1C only applies to tenants, while subsections 1A and B applies to tenants or other parties. As for the use of double registered mail, according to subsection 1B, courier is mentioned, and double registered mail is not precluded under courier service, so there's a flexibility to such. So these are all ways in which documents could be served. Ms. Yuan Xiong, I have a question on subsection 1C. Why is there no provision on personal service to an adult occupier at the premises? There could be multiple persons at a premises. How could you know whether the recipient is the occupier or an adult occupier? Thank you very much. Under subsection 1A, by personal service, this refers to service of documents in person to the intended recipient. This is one of the options. I do not quite understand your second question. Under 1C1, leaving the specified document with an adult occupier instead of handing over the document in person. What is meant by leaving the specified document with an adult occupy, what does that actually mean? But this is not the same as personal service. So what is meant by leaving the specified document? Our understanding is that you could leave a document in the premises, but you cannot leave the specified document with a specified person. So how can you know that the document is left with an adult occupier? When we say leaving the specified document with an adult occupier, then the condition is that the adult occupier, an adult occupier must be seen at the premises. So an adult occupier must be identified and seen before a document could be left with him or her. But as to how we actually decide that a person is an adult occupier, it depends on the actual circumstances. So this is one of the ambiguities as to whether the recipient is an adult occupier. So this could be a contentious point. And the recipient might argue that he or she is not an adult occupier. So this is an ambiguity.
Commissioner. Well, the party who serves the document has to satisfy the court that indeed the document has been served. And now here is about serving it to the tenant. And the person who serves the document will have to consider whether he is confident in leaving the specified document with the adult occupier. Otherwise, the service would be invalid if he has not made a reasonable consideration. But the occupier doesn't have to be the tenant. It can be a friend of the tenant over 18 years old. He might have come into use the bathroom. He doesn't live there, but he can still be an occupier. I think it depends on the circumstances of the case. Now, if the person doesn't live there, he's just there to see a friend, I don't think that will satisfy the definition of occupier. So the occupier has to be the tenant. Is that there may be five or six persons living, and any of them who sold for 18 can be an adult occupier. He has to live there, right? Usually, let's say a couple lives there. The tenant is the husband. Then his wife is the occupier, is an occupier. We extend the meeting by 15 minutes. Let's see if we can complete the clause-by-clause scrutiny. If not, we will wait till the next time. Subsection 5. Interpretation of 128 to add the definition for agent, commissioner, house owner, premises, to add a landlord, regulated tenancy, and subdivided unit. Okay. 6 and 7 can be read together. It amends section 129 and 131 of the ordinance. Now, summoning of tenant of premises with a rateable value not exceeding $100,000 unlawfully holding over. Now, if the tenancy has expired, even though the landlord has served a notice to recover the SDU, and the tenant has refused to return the unit. Then the district court can summons the tenant to appear in court at a certain time and date to give the reasons for refusal to deliver the premises. So we have added subsection 2 here. For the purpose of subsection 1, if the premises to be recovered are a SDU subject to a regulated tenancy, the owner of the premises or the owner's agent must, in the relevant application, specify whether or not the regulated tenancy is created out of another tenancy. Now, for section 131, if a person served with an originating summons fails to appear before the district court at the time and place mentioned in the summons, or fails to show cause why he should not quit and deliver up possession of the premises, the district court may issue a warrant to any bailiff of the court of first instance or the district court commanding him to enter into the premises and give possession of the same to the owner thereof of his agent. Now we will renumber this to section 1311, and then we also add subsection 2. For the purposes of subsection 1, if the premises are subdivided and subject to a regulated tenancy, and B, the regulated tenancy is created out of another tenancy, the district court must, in issuing a warrant to a bailiff of the court of first instance or the district court, include a condition in the warrant that the execution of the warrant is to be stayed for 60 days. And 3, however, subsection 2 does not apply if the person making the application under subsection 1291 is the landlord of the regulated tenancy for the premises. For the amendments to section 129 and 131 is to add is because of section 128AJ. So the holding over requirement for a landlord trying to recover a premises under a regulated tenancy will still apply to a subtenancy. All right. Fifth schedule already completed. We'll now look at related consequences to part 3 is 070, page 70. Division 1 Amendment to Lands Tribunal Ordinance. It amends Section 9 of the Lands Tribunal Ordinance by adding Section 8AA. The tribunal has jurisdiction on an application to determine whether any tenancy is a regulated tenancy for the purposes of Part 4A of the Landlord and Tenant Consolidation Ordinance. And then to amend Subsidiarization A originating application. Now, before the subheading of Section 68, we will add the small headings 4 and 4A. And then I will also amend subsection form to require the section 22 form be submitted, and to amend Lands Tribunal Rules Form 22 so that applications are for determining of whether tenancy is a regulated tenancy for the purpose of Part 4A of Cap 7. An application for termination on the entitlement of a family member of a deceased tenant to the deceased tenant's benefits and protection under regulated tenancy under Cap 7. Division 3 Amendment to Lands Tribunal Fees Rules Cap 17 Sublect B. Amending the schedule of Cap 17 Sublect B. So in subsection, and there are fees for application under these parts in cap 7. And division for amendments to reading ordinance. To amend 6A of cap 116 in 2B, we add the following. A notice submitted to the Commission under section 120AAZS2, and also a requisition served on a person under section 1191A or 120AAZU1, so that the notice and the requisition can be admissible as evidence in front of the court. Division 5, Amendment to Land Registration Ordinance, Cap 128. Clause 15 amends Section 3.2 of Cap 128. Now for Subsection 2, all such deeds, conveyances, and other instruments, etc., if they're not registered, is against any subsequent bona fide purchaser or mortgagee for valuable consideration of the same parcels of ground, etc., will be null and void. However, provided nothing therein contained shall extend to bona fide leases at recurrence for any term not exceeding 3 years or to a regulated tenancy. So the second term tenancy rent may not satisfy the definition for the full rent. And so what said here should extend that. So we are proposing to amend the proviso under 3.2. So even though there is not bona fide leases at rent, it will still be covered. And also Division 6, to amend amendments to Government Rent Assessment and Collection Ordinance. This amends Section 39. So there will be amendment to Section 2 of to 39.3, and that is return to requisition, includes in addition to a return to requisition within the meaning of Subsection 2. A notice admitted to the commissioner under this section. Okay, yes. Division 7, amendment to electronic transactions amendment. Amending Schedule 3, first item of electronics transaction ordinance to add sections 119Y1Z and B and 128AZZG1A and B so that they will apply. Because 120AAZZG1A and B allows a service of the notice by means of electronic form means and physical means. So now if the electronic information can be inspected in future, then the information can be served to the designated person with the designated electronic means. That ends the bill. So after 5 meetings, we've completed cross-by-cross scrutiny of the bill, thanks to members' participation. But that is not the end of the bill's committee's work, because there will be CSAs from members. So let me repeat once again. We are going to discuss CSAs from members at the meeting next Monday. If members have other amendments, please let us have them within this week so that the administration will have enough time to consider those amendments. The meeting ends here, and the next meeting is scheduled for 2:30, or rather, the morning. The next meeting is scheduled for 10:45 a.m. next Monday. We'll continue on Monday. Thank you very much.